Speaker.
Hi, everybody. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
I'm Katie Kuzek. I'm Programs Chair. Thanks for coming out tonight. Happy Valentine's Day, everybody. It's nice to see that there's other people who couldn't get a date tonight. I'd like to Esther Tanzman. She's going to talk to us tonight about her trip hiking in New Zealand, and she's promised lots of pictures. Thank you.
Rats.
This picture up here is from Captain Cook's first voyage, showing what they look like. And this is from a newspaper from New Zealand. Just to reiterate, almost all the pictures are mine. I try and say which ones are not, but the vast majority I took myself. So then, the whites come. So the Dutch first were the first ones, quote, to discover New Zealand. But they didn't like it. They didn't even get off the boat. They left. Over 120 odd years later, Captain Cook came. He came three times. And that said, well, you know, a lot of whales and seals, so a lot of them came. Missionaries came. And they kept whaling until they almost got rid of too many whales. The Brits, of course, like they always do, started sending lots of people over. Not prisoners like Australia, but just normal people. But there was a lot of lawlessness. They were stealing land from the Maori. The Maori happens to be a fighting set of indigenous people, so there was a lot of tribal warfare. And it got so lawless that in 1840, they got this Treaty of Waitangi. It was the same time that British made New Zealand a colony of the Brits. So this treaty was supposed to protect their way of life, protect their land, let them control their own resources. Did that really happen? So with all this time, you know, there was actually a war between the Maori and the Brits, all fighting about land. And guess what? Gold, gold. What did that do? Bring more people. So as New Zealand was developing, there was a lot of sheep farms, sheep were brought in. And Britain found out, just like here, you know, let's send stuff back to the motherland. So it became a major supplier to Britain in the 1800s. And that, of course, impacted the land. The forests grew bigger, they did towns, railroads, and they brought things in, like plants and animals, that did not belong. But they did certain good things. The first country in the world to grant women the vote was New Zealand. The Maori actually got parliamentary seats and could vote if they owned land. And the New Zealanders were still very tied to Great Britain. So they fought for Britain in many wars. They got their independence in 1907, but in World War I, they sent troops, and they were incredibly proud of the work that they did in the war. In fact, they landed at Gallipoli in Turkey, and it was regarded as a coming of age, that we are a real country. And they typically joined with the Australians for a joint cooperation. And they fought in ongoing supporting the Allies in multiple wars. So what do we call New Zealanders? Kiwis! Here it is. Somebody asked what this is. Now, have you ever seen the little boot polish that says Kiwi on it? In the circle? That is from this time period. Now I can take my Kiwi off. This is the pack I use. There was cartoons, they played rugby, British sport. And there was some cartoons. This is a moa, which is a very large indigenous bird that has been extinct because of polar hunting, and the Kiwis. So they started in these little commons, the boot polish. It was a nickname first for the country, but when they went to war, they actually called the people Kiwis, and that's what stayed. So Kiwis are a very interesting bird. It's a national bird. The Maori use their feathers for valuable cloaks. It's related to emus from Australia and moas, but they don't fly, and they're big. They don't have a tail. They have no breastbone, sternum, so they get crushed easily. And they're nighttime feeders. But this is just what a Kiwi looks like. Very unusual birds. There's no big floppy wings. one in real life. I don't know where they got it. This one is off the internet. But I did see one in a sanctuary where they kept it room dark, so they reversed their circadian rhythm, so we could see them with like little blue lights. And they're big birds. So why is New Zealand so special? Why does everybody want to go? Well, because it was isolated so long. It has barely any lifetime of humans living there, considering the rest of the world. There are no natural predators. This area was very isolated, so it grew up on its own. There are no snakes. The only native mammals are bats and the marine, the whales and seals and things. And there's a tremendous number of hiking. They call them great walks. And they are incredibly proud of these walks. They're incredibly well maintained. They're clean. And the bathrooms actually had toilet paper. So let's get started. So just a very quick perusal. Flew into Auckland. What the Rhodes Scholar did was we spent three, 4 nights in one hotel, and they would bus us out for hikes every day or some activity. They never let us sit. So from here, we then went around here, flew down to Christchurch, then explored the Southern Islands, Fiordland, and took a ferry to Stewart Island, a ferry back, flew to Wellington, through to Auckland, and back. So what are you not allowed to bring into New Zealand?
Snakes.
You got it. No muddy boots. They know you're hiking, you have to take off your boots and show them they have to be spotless on the bottom. So the way the trip went, the way of this presentation, is like by day I'll show you what we did, by day and we'll run through it. This is their big international airport, it's not that big. So we went and drove, 2 hours or so at the Hamilton Gardens. And this is just a brief example. There's a lot of gardens in New Zealand, a lot. And they're all meticulously maintained, different styles. Then we went to the glowworm cave in this town, Tarangi. Glowworms are insects that glow in the dark, so you can go into this area and they have very minimal light. You see all this glowing, you're not allowed to take photos, so that's not mine. And so this was originally owned by the Maori. They lost it, but then they got it back, and it's run with the Department of Conservation. And this is a typical structure that the Maori have. So we then did a hike to the falls, and every hike you see has a picture of where you're going, mileage, with everything. So you really know it's just incredibly well, not like, where's the trail mark, where's, no, lovely. So beautiful, I'm a plant person, beautiful flowers, beautiful plants. This is a fantail that I took a picture of, but it actually spreads its tail out like this to catch insects somehow or other. Black swan. And it's just more on the hike. Very old tree world. This was the falls that we walked to, beautiful water. A lot of growth on the trees, mushroom, anybody mushroom stuff, not me. And the next day, so this is the next day. You can tell Nancy she's in a picture. As a woman from Rochester. So a beautiful walk again up to these falls, orchids, just showing you wherever you walk, we just saw these mountains and scenery. So now, we'll see if anybody knows their world. What mountain is this? Mount Doom in the Lord of the Rings. people go to New Zealand to trace where they filmed a lot of the rings. It's really pretty interesting. A lot of it was right, you know, right there in different areas. We saw some of it. But the indigenous folks don't really want you calling it Mount Doom. It's Mount So the Tongariro National Park is one of their most famous parks. It has three active volcanoes. It gets a lot of people visiting. It was our biggest hike. So there's this Alpine crossing that goes between craters, volcanoes, mountains. You can see how we started at ground and hiked up. It was pretty good hike up. So it's between these mountains and craters, very dry. And it took us all day. And this, you know, we climbed all the way up to the top of this. This doesn't look so bad here, but it was actually quite steep and filled with scree. So it's actually pretty hard to meander down. We got down here, we had lunch here. We saw these beautiful turquoise and emerald lakes. And then we had to walk another 6 miles to get out. Next day, they let us rest a little bit because we had that big hike. And we had the biggest hike very early on this trip, so we knew we could do it. So they let us hang out a little bit in the morning. I think we went to a heated tub that day. And we, of course, have to walk. And this one was a short walk of only 3 miles. And this was fairly typical. This is Peter. You know, talking to part of the group, he knew a lot of the trees and the vegetation. And again, everything is well walked. They tell you it's a loop, you know, 2 hours, how long. So again, we saw more orchids. This is a fern before it opens up. You know, they curl up at the fronds and then they pop open. And this is the leg that we went around. And this is a peyote fern. This was like huge, like way up tree like. And you just look up and see a fern, nothing like we have here. All around with the old fronds falling down. Next to Rotura, which is another city, this Tipia is a Maori cultural center and a geothermal center. So they built this very large cultural center for people to learn about the indigenous population of the country. They actually had school. We saw them teaching people how to do the wood carvings, stone carvings. They had them on display. There's a huge weaving display in classes. There's all these mud pools and such. And we actually got to see, you know, a traditional dance and song. And then we went to the geothermal part. It looks just like Yellowstone. Wait a second. That's Yellowstone all the way down. So the same geysers, mud piles, steam, just like Yellowstone. Everything I've seen in Yellowstone. But they actually use the geothermal energy. They convert, not right in this part, but they do convert the heat from the geothermal area into electricity. And then we went into the cultural center. We had a tour. And just to review again, you know, this is a representation of what some of their life looked like. And you know, they do have some self-determination, some protection of lands, ownership, and representation in parliament. But as you see in 1975, it said, you lied and you cheated and you stole, you white guys. You know, this is not right. This is not what the treaty that I mentioned earlier before. So slowly but surely, they're working on improving things. So it seemed, you know, we had white guys, mostly talking to white folks. It seemed like they're way ahead of a lot of other indigenous population. But I don't know that they feel that. We didn't know enough. Their language is actually an official language. Tongariro is their official language. We see signs all over the place with both languages. And the country is called and you have to take the ferry and do it. So they flew us there the same time. Sorry, we have to go through the... Sorry. I did this without the ads, but you can't stop it.
Right, yeah.
So that is the cartoonist from